Sí, si esto se si hiciera un crash,
sí.
Es cuestión de hacer stop.
Stop y estar.
Vete aquí a Encoding Options, sobre todo. Asegúrate. Y antes de hacer el start, esto esté chequeado. Porque si no, no se graba.
Save to file. También, ¿no?
Y no hay más.
Listo. ¿Vale? Listo. Cualquier cosa, avisa abajo.
Sí, lo sé. Bueno,
the work I'm presenting here has been related to these two pillars. function of your application. So here you have hard coded flow functions. And then if you want to have an underlying programmable software, then you need to enable the users to define this function flow themselves online. So here you have specific flow of function among your components. You get a specific output. If you change that flow of function online, then you get a new output. So it's of course important to ensure that the output is predictable, because end users want to have predictable results. So even if you allow end user programmability of your application, you still need to ensure that those changes are going to have the predictable results for end users. And situated lifecycle management is about for any domain object that end users care about, or like activity intelligence, you need to situate that object in the context of the process that has created that object. It's very important to have context-related information. It's about allowing dynamic definition of control flow, execution of those control flows, and lifecycle management of those executions. Okay, the solution approach, I don't have time, unfortunately, to go into detail, but the whole solution approach is about embedding a domain-specific modeling language into your web application, and you deploy the application, it embeds such a language. So the diversity of the domain and unpredictability of changes, so the number of workflows that you know, is managed in my approach by providing a meta language framework. I will briefly explain what I mean by that. And then we also address implementation and identification of changes, because you know that your domain is going to change, but you need to have insight about those changes. Changes themselves are unpredictable, but to implement the software that allows control change of your software functionality, you need to have a knowledge about the patterns of those changes. So we assume that the patterns can be identified, the rules that govern those changes can be identified. Well, this means that an analysis activity can be done through the domain design. And of course, the lifecycle management will be used for smart behavior requirements like prediction, what's going to happen given what has happened in the past. Okay, so the meta language stuff is, so if you have considered the framework that I have implemented, you have this meta language, and then by two domain-driven design, you identify the specific requirements of your domain language, and then you specialize that framework, and you get a domain-specific language for your web app. Then you do standard web programming, like if you use CSide, you design, you implement your web components using CSide and Smalltalk. Then your end users get a hand, like in this Yodel project that I talked about. One of the project's goals is to define e-courses. So context application, but at that time it wasn't a framework for developing such, such application, but just a research prototype where we had this drag and drop style of programming dedicated to matching programming wireless sets of applications. Yeah, we have a few assumptions. When you start implementing these applications, you need to consider that you, whether your domain requirements are going to change. So if your requirements are stable, you don't need an application. We assume that changes. So the application is changing in an unpredictable way, so you cannot define your flow of control and the comfort of an application at deployment time. But still, we assume that the patterns of those changes can be known through specifically domain view analysis. And we also assume that those patterns can be packed into a language using the method that is behind this framework. And also, we assume that your end user are ready and motivated to program. So, like in this case, indicator providers, they say that they are willing to learn and they, because they, it will help them in better performing their services. So last, just a word about implementation. The current framework is implemented on the top of CSIG and PIR, as I said. I'm not sure whether it could be implemented in any other language. At least I don't, I can't imagine, so to be honest. But, well, we don't know. There are so many languages in the literature. As far as I know, one of the main technical aspects of this framework is that at some point, when you define online a flow model, a control flow, you're the interpreter of that control flow when you execute your activity needs to give the hand so to pass the flow of control to a C-side component or any web component, and then it gets back the control when that component has finished its execution. CSIG provides you a very neat solution to implement this. It's very easy to address. Okay, a live demo is at afacms.com. The site is currently password protected, but so actually the login is afacms.com if you want to play with it. And the password is OPOMP. This afternoon I will go, if I have time, I will happily show you a demo right now, otherwise this afternoon. Yeah, so as I mentioned, we wanted seamless integration of online programmability with content management. So I came up with an architecture where if you look at the left side of this slide, you get a content management system like peer service comes with a hierarchical structure of nodes with pages, so your end user pages, let's say, and the internal pages of your content management system, your sort of administration pages. My approach has been to add new types of nodes into this architecture, so as you can add the concept, the domain concepts, are actually represented explicitly in the system. Whatever concept that end users care about, your business objects, account, and what you like. Your contracts, the primitive functions that the system uses to allow defining more complex functionality are also explicitly represented in the system. You can browse them, you can edit them, you can add new content. So it's basically a documentation tool at that level. And activities. An activity is a new functionality that you add to the system. It is also implemented as a type of content, a specific type of content. It's very, very So if you look at, this is just an example, activities are sets of actions and actions are sets of operations. So the graphical interface is organized that the activity renders itself, then renders its action, and the each action renders its operation. So it's a sort of recursive functionality. So each component can render a menu, a footer, and extra information, a header, things like that. Just as a demo, I don't have probably time to go into accepting the questions, but I started with the two components that are provided by the community. So one of them is a component by Andras Rab that allows connecting to Twitter and sending messages to Twitter. Another one is posted by Nick and Elliot to suicide mailing list. This component has been implemented during the London workshop and it allows fetching some streaming about traffic info in southeastern London. But I started by these two components, and I abstracted, like sort of by refactoring those components, I get one service which is logging to Twitter. So you have the whole code, so this is what I call a mapping service. You have the basic low-level code logic that do something useful for you. So like logging to Twitter. Actually, the whole code is quite complex, but what you are interested in just interface. Login, get inline traffic info, this is another service. Interactive tweeting service, so you get the traffic information, this is a message. You get your connection to Twitter by executing the other service, and then you pass them as an argument to your interactive tweeting service, and then it sends the message to Twitter using that connection. And gives you back the Twitter communication where you know what you have communicated, what you have tried to communicate, and what has been the result of that communication, whether Twitter has accepted you. And then you have a Y2 atomic service, so control structures are not implemented, hard-coded in the language, they are also implemented as atomic service. And the whole logic, so if you wanted, for those that know Seaside, if when you deploy your application, you know your logic, you just write it like that, it's very neat. But if you don't know this logic and you want to do it online, you could go through my system. It's just a question of adding two operations, logging to Twitter, Y2, and Y2 gets again as arguments the whole block of operations. It's getting that traffic info and sent to Twitter. And as long as the second operation returns true, the system your activity is right. So applications to the energy, I talked about that. Another application perspective is to delegate to domain experts the identification of the business logic, because when you have legacy applications, sometimes the application is not documented well, and you need to identify the actual logic that it has been implemented. A lot of other perspectives model upstream and execution environments. You could have web-based ecosystems like this, like a geo, logic, tree talk, and other blocks at a time means sequences, conditionals, iterations. This is what I have met. But in Turing, you could even implement recursion. So it allows implementing quite expressive languages. And I could show you actually. You have this notion of, you know, high level functions you can pass, like you do it in Smalltalk, you can pass blocks as arguments to your operation. An activity is basically defined based on only two concepts, action and operation. So an action is a set of operations, and an operation takes a set of arguments and returns a result. But the thing is that you can have as argument to an operation a whole action. And custom structures are implemented as an operation that take an action as arguments. And then the system is not, nothing is hard-coded basically, so you could add depending on the requirements and the mental model of your end user. The idea of end user programming is to develop a language that matches as best as possible the mental model of your end user. Knowing that in some areas end users are already programmed, like in dimensional programming, but in other areas, like in K-provision, people are not end users, but they say that they are willing to learn to program because they can provide better services.
Demo.
Yeah, sure. Measure because I have worked hard on this demo. Actually, in the paper, you see some graphical interfaces that are not called the same because I decided to give her something for you more accurate than what I had at that time. I hope that it will be a success. You never know with online demos. Yeah, the you see something. Is it better? So the design of this homepage is by Silence Network. You get here, so this is our idea. We could have a sort of Google, but instead of searching strings, you search for functionalities inside the app. So it is important to have in mind that this is not a general purpose web application. It is designed for specific end users for their specific needs, like in an intranet. So we have a group of end users and they come to the system. This interface is not for your final end users, it is for your administrators, your end user programmers. But you could come here and search for an activity. Like, this is also the jQuery interface behind is dying down, so I have to create a session. Hopefully it works. Yeah. So I have activities are organized in terms of terms. So here we have two terms of activities and we can create a new one. You can go to the shopping activity, which is the example that I developed in the paper. So you get here the shopping terms, and inside this shopping term you have currently one activity, which is sushi shopping activity. If I add a new activity, it's just, you know, workshop. You provide us a screen. Give a name to your activity, and you get a new activity, and so forth. So what happens inside an activity? You have a whole bunch of functionality. Some of them are not yet implemented, like export XML. This is things that we are in the process of being developed, but you can design your activity. So if you look at the design of this sushi shopping, because I mentioned it in the paper, so you basically, this is an activity composed of three actions. Any activity has necessarily a main action, and then you can add as many actions as you need. So the main action is like a sequence of operations. It not necessarily needs to be a sequence, but here it is a sequence because people reason in terms of sequence of things. The first thing is this one, I will go actually to the other action. So this is the definition of the other action, which is field of the first. Operation is feel it and then come feel it. But let me now define a new activity. So this is the demo that I suggested. Go to log into Twitter and then read the traffic info and then send it to Twitter. So that's adding a new. Thank you. a link, and when you click on this link, you can allow also a connection to Twitter. Everything goes well. Twitter gives you hand back, and then here you have, can you see it? Yeah, I have to log in, yeah, I have to log in.
structure on, a, on an object. So you create the structure and plug it on the structure. So what do you want to know? That's a very creative trait, or what if you want a specific trait or if you want a global trait. So we have to a question important. And all shows between inheritance and traits. It's a very important question. And can traits be used as natural verbs? So the context. I implement the collection hierarchy of power. So there are a lot of little programs I try to improve, like the cancel method or that's collection, power collection hierarchy. What's a trait? A trait is a block of methods who can be used like a behavior. And traits need some method. It's a required method because like as the traits traits in Perl are stateless. So for example, we can we have to put accessors in tray if you want to use it in the object of in the behavior of the traits. So that's an example of the use of the traits. We create T-2, so it's a trait who needed inferior and equals, and give the method at the left. So we put in the code of string number and date the European method, and we can use the traits, and the traits give the methods give the methods to the object. So granularity. So I present in this part the protocol, the granularity I use to block project. So first, I create an hierarchy of all specific behavior of collection, like orderer, undecidable, sequencer, all the specific behavior of the collection. So that's not the real trait, because I create a small trait to be more, to have a smallest granularity, to be more modular. For this is the real trait I implement. For example, T order have 9 traits. So accessing, adding, collections, copying, creation, all the stuff that all collection needed. Not at all, because for example, array do not need the T add, T array add, because an array is not forever. So we don't need T array again. But we can, if we want, we can create a behavior T array by adding, but it's not important. So I we have to look at local needs. So that takes time. So discussion. Traits and granularity. Granularity of traits are depending of the project. On the collection, we decide to have the granularity with the global collection vehicle. That's really depends. But no, we don't have solution of the good granularity. It's I think that aren't good solution for this. Trans granularity. So with other set we assess the good granularity of trans. Because we have replaced the collection very fast. We have a library which we use for credit collection. That's interesting too, that to only have to recreate collection loading library, because if you want, you can have only the base. If we want, for example, another collection, for example, we don't have it, we take in the library, and we recreate it very fast. So, trace the uses inheritance. I use the inheritance to create to have a semantic part, because all of my objects I created, all location I created with the traits, I inherit them with collection. Like that, we can say it's a kind of collection. But traits based inheritance are. I can't say what's the good one, but I think we have to use twice to have we have to use the twice to have good class object. It's different because we think about it sometimes.
wondering, I had another question, and it looks like this would be better done offline because of the problems with the machines.
You mean that the code would be better done offline?
Yes, and I had another question. I was just wondering if that would be better. Okay. In 2005, at the ESIG at Brussels, I presented an example of metaprogramming where traits with state would be useful. Do you know if anyone has looked at that? And if not, might that be an example for studying traits? In 2005, at ESIG in Brussels, I presented an example of metaprogramming where traits might be useful, but I thought it would require state. I was wondering if anyone had looked at that example, or if not, is that perhaps an example that could be investigated? I offer it as a case to look at. Sorry? Okay, right. It's written up in the design discussions part of the 2005 report. So kind of if you look at it there and if you're interested, I'll happily talk much more about it.
Right. I'm the author of a statement first.
Yeah, good.
I can't have a good point of view.
Do this offline.
There is still time.
Okay.
I would rather not.
Okay. Yeah, my,
it's 30 minutes.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, second time. My watch is obviously fast.
But no.
Thank you.
play.
The But no, it's not the same. I think we can make a much simpler solution. And another problem that we selected is that it doesn't support grouping objects in a smart way. So that will be selected. Then we have Melt, which is implemented in Java. And the idea is that imagine an application that, because of a bug, it's leaking objects. This is our case, that objects that are created reference, but usually they are not used, but they are being used. So they develop a same kind of virtual memory where they detect these objects that were not used, but still referenced, and he sold it to this. So with this, he avoids the application from crashing because it doesn't have any enough primary memory, and then he puts all these objects in this. You have to support memory disk, not to fit them, but at least not to crash the application so that you can still use it. And the next one is in assignment, and it just is not a virtual memory mechanism or something like that, but it's just a tool to swap out and use it to swap out object to graph. And we thought that in assignment could be a very good experiment to understand the problem. So I will talk a few slides later about imassigning and what we have been doing. The main problem is that no one solved all of the problems that we want to solve, mostly that they don't group the options in a smart way so that we can release really a lot of primary memory. Some others are quite complex here, like loop, for example, much more complex, and there is the performance. No one has the performance that we would like to. The performance and we would like to be less overhead in the throughput of the system. So if we want to think of a solution, we have different challenges that are the most important ones. The first, and this is funny, but I promise you, this is the most important challenge, is to not to use much more memory with our solution than the one that we were able to solve. And this is so stupid that this, because, I know, and you think you have a solution, but then you realize that for the solution you have to use much more memory than the one that you've been able to release. Just I give you an example. Today we were thinking that maybe we should need a back pointer so that the object can point to the one that I pointed to him because of the option traverse. And maybe that's a good idea, but if I need to add that for each object, I have to use much more memory and probably will be more than the one that I can release. So each solution that we think, we have this problem. So we need to find a solution not to use too much memory. The other one is the overhead, because of course, when you swap out and then you send a message and you want it now the object, but now it's this. So you need to swap it and do something decal. So we have to be aware of not to have a high overhead. And the last one is, as I told you, how to group objects in a smart way. But I will explain later why this is very important. So the aspect of our solution, or our future solution, is to mark and trace the object at runtime. Not because you can do a static analysis, but our idea is that the system, while running, it starts to detect this unused object, so that maybe until certain situations, you're like, okay, now I want to swap. But not that at that moment I check. No, the system was doing that in the background, and then when, I don't know, you have 80% of memory occupied and you want to release, or whenever it needs to trigger, it swaps. And the idea is to detect it in runtime. The same is the usage of proxies, because we say that I said, right, and I wanted to load back automatically the objects when they are needed. So the idea that if you swap an object to a subgraph of object, you let a proxy in the image alive, and that proxy knows how to recover back the serialized object using that absolute understanding or something like that. And finally, the last thing that we thought of the way of grouping the object could be the subgraph. The grouping object by its reference between the object. And I will explain about that. So why is it so important to replace each object by a proxy. At the end, I want to replace, I want to free too much memory. Because I will have one object, I free one. And so maybe the only difference may be the amount of instance variables, but it's not that large. So we ideally we would like to swap a group of objects and just let few or one process in the image so that we can release much memory. So why is graph? This is the second question. Because we found two important things. The first one is that probably when you have a functionality in your system, suppose I want to support UTF-8 encoding, maybe you need a group of objects. But it's probably that if you need one object, you probably need the other of that subgraph. And when you don't need one, you maybe just do not need the other ones. Like they act together, they work together. So we are thinking that grouping them in the subgraph are it's a smart choice, maybe we will see from this point of view. And the last one is because if we have subgraph and we want to let to replace by proxies, it's easy because you only need to replace the root of the subgraph by proxies. So we use few proxies and we release more memory. So basically, that's the idea. What we did so far is just few things. We didn't very much. We modified the VM, the script VM, to mark and trace the object computed. We just modify the object header and use a bit. So when an object receives a message, it puts the flag in on to say, okay, I am being used. So having that, we could do some analysis and visualization of the scene. For example, I got a stat analysis where I put all the objects in zero with that flag, for example, with flag in off, and make a stat analysis. Then I can do something, whatever you want, and then you find like that. And once that is done, I can check which object were I used during that. So then I can visualize, and we did, for example, some visualization with moves, where you can visualize which classes has instances that were I used, and which one has incident, but they were not used, etc. Finally, we took different statistics about the different scenarios. Because maybe if you have 80% of the object are used, maybe it doesn't make sense to do this, all this stuff. So the idea is, okay, let's see, take some statistics about really how much we are using of the image and see if it's worth it or not. So for example, this is again, we took a C-site application. It was a production image, so it was a firm core image after running the cleanup for production method that removes the text and all the options that may not be used. We start the analysis, and what we do is to navigate the whole set application. We go each of the links, each use case, and we navigate the whole web application. And at the end, the result is that only 4% of the objects were used in that 4% of the, we navigate a whole image and it was firewall production, but I mean, it couldn't be even smaller, maybe. And that 4% of the object represents the 15% of the memory. Because I guess this is the difference, because 4%, I think, because I don't want to lie, but a big portion of that 4% was for bitmaps because of the war. So that is because why it's much more the percentage of the memory than the amount of options, because there were bitmaps. Bitmaps occupy much more memory than other. So what we get with this is that the scenario is very, very promising. If we can really do something, it's amazing. And we think that's one of the problems we want to do with the image based languages. You have a lot of stuff that you probably don't use. So if you want to think in a lot of good things. And there are a lot of problems also that when you are loading back something that you export, that maybe to have a duplicate, classical shape, and we are going to see it later. But what they want to show that one of the biggest problems is the speed. Everywhere you need speed, because if you take 2 seconds to swap out, or you need 2 seconds to swap in, it won't be useful. Because imagine a web application where the user gets 2 seconds waiting. So we think that the speed is very important. So when we talk about subgraphics, there are such an option that needs to be clarified, certain type of option that I want to make clear, have the same vocabulary. So for in this picture, you can see, for example, the blue objects, A to C, are the root of our subgraph. Because we usually work with a subgraph. Because the primary memory is the large option graph, and we usually work with a little with pieces of that. So we work with subgraphs. We always swap subgraphs. So we have the root of the subgraph, in this case, A, B, and C, with blue color. Then you have the external object, that are objects inside, outside of our graph, and then point to objects inside our graph. For example, X, Z, and Y. They are this brown color. And finally, and this is maybe the most too complicated, are the inner object and the shared objects. Inner object, we call it the object that are only accessible through the root of the graph. For example, in this case, E is only accessible from A. I is only accessible from E or B, but it's always inside the subgraph. But for example, F is accessible from B, but also from S. Mm-hmm. You see the difference?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And this is the key. This is a key important. It's a very important definition for class assignment, and we will see. So, if you try to think in a general solution for swapping this, there's a lot of problems that you might face. For example, if do I want to include the whole subgraph into a disk or only the inner option? Because for example, do I want to swap F? Because X is still pointing to it. So if I remove it, what I do with that reference from X to F? And you put also a proxy there. I don't know. But maybe another way is just to swap out the inner object that are only referenced from inside the subgraph. And maybe that is enough. And I keep shared objects in memory. So that's an important decision. The second is that she moves the objects. Moves around the compartation and I don't know where. So for example, if suppose I put H and L in the file, I swap it and H and L and H point to J also, but this point, when we an object point to another one, is that it has the memory address of the object here, of that option. So if I put that in a disk, and I know you maybe 1 week or 1 hour later, this object was moved by the GC. It happened. So this memory address that H kept is wrong. So if we want to swap out this object and they point to object that remain in the image, we need to do something because they should see move the object. That's something that we have to deal with. Just change it is an analytical problem. We have an object, we swap it, the image change it, the class change it, it renames, it adds an instant variable, it remove an instant variable or whatever. Now I load back what I swap. You need to update that instance of that class. Even now it has changed. So you need to, if the class had an interpolate, you need to update those objects to have that environment. Or maybe it doesn't happen that, maybe, and I think this is actually what happened in assignment, when you change, 2 minutes? Oh. Yeah, 2 minutes. Okay.
I'll take 5.
Yes, okay, so I need to update it. In the assignment already, when you recreate a class, the class builder call its instance to update it. So if you call it instance, if the instance were swapped out, it will be loaded in not in primary memory. We are in the same problem, so we need a relative offset. And okay, we say that the routes are requested by proxies. And finally, it uses the HTC facilities to detect which objects are shared objects and which objects are inner objects. Because that's difficult to know, but I don't have time to explain. So, image segment has two important instance variables that decrease. One is the serialized objects word array, and the other is the shared object array. Serialized objects are word array, in where you are going to put the root and the inner object, and they will be put in a word array. This means that will be byte, word, and I will put there the serialized object, and that's what is going to swap. And the shared object array is just a normal array that points to the shared object, and this array remains in memory, it's not swapped. So, the first thing it does in a segment is to copy the root of the object into the segment, into the serialized object word array. When it copies both the object here plus its instance variable. Okay? The problem is that the pointer to the instance variable, there is still pointing to the object in primary memory. So again, they will have to be fixed so that it points to its relative addresses. But I will remove the reference in this context, but remember that those objects are still pointing to the object in primary memory. So once this is done, it will start to iterate into the serialized object array. So we start with A. Okay, A. Who do you point to? Okay, D and E. So that D is shared option. It was black, shared option. So you put D, this is a normal array. So it will point to the, I mean, that will be a pointer. So when you create an array, you need to duplicate the object, just a pointer. So it will go to zero. Then it gets more of E. So E is an inner object, so it has to be swapped. So it is, sorry, I forgot to say something. In the previous case, when it does that, it also updates the A option, the A option, so that it points to the offset in the shared object array. So that with that, he can recreate it after reloading. So the offset can be maybe the position in the right, for example. So then in the turn of E, we said that it was inner option, it's copied into the select option to the right, and the same happens. And it's updated so that it points to an offset in the file. Probably it's not the index, like in the right, because here I'm just pointing, but here each option occupies a different side. So maybe it's just the offset in the file or something like that. But it's important that it's a relative address and it's not pointing to the primary memory. So at the end, the whole graph is traversed in the same way. It turns to B, and then to C, and then to E at the end. But in an option will be added until the whole graph is traversed. So at the end, this is what you cook up. It's quite a mess, but you don't care. The important thing here is this. You see, this is all mess. The important thing is that the options, I mean, you don't need to follow the arrows. The important thing is that the shared options, they all point to relative addresses, or to the segment, to that array, or to that one. And they're all pointing to offset, not to. So with that, I can load it back later, and the shared option array remains in memory. And if the HTC move this box, that array will be updated automatically by the HTC. So at the time of loading, those points would be correct. You understand? How do you solve the problem?
Well, the shared objects are just created on one box and it stays the same.
Yes, it stays there. So finally, the last step is to replace the root by proxies. Then we say that they were going to load back the selected object. But the roots, they don't point to the object. They are an instance of a proxy image segment class. So they don't point to this object. So that reference are removed because they are proxy. They indeed they point to the image segment instance. So when I did that, now nobody likes to point to the inner object. And now if the HTC runs, that's the machine. Now it removes and collects the serialized the load option. And that's how I swap them. And finally, we take the right, we take the serialized object for the right, they are all encoded, they are just bytes in an array, in B inside cause indeed it does a smart usage of the GC to detect the inner and the shared option if someone is like tell you after. And the president you have to be aware of the shared options because if you want to swap this graph and 80% are shared options, they will remain in memory and you will be able to swap only the 20% of the options. So you need to be careful not to have a lot of shared options. That's all.
Mentioning that technique's used a lot with dates too. You can compute, you get your new date is actually the unique date. And there of course you can compute and find it in that structure.
That's the biggest the biggest problem that we have to face for the moment. I mean, in a segment, they are user-defined in graph. I mean, the input for IMA segment is a right of good. So for that, you have to provide it. In my solution, that I try to think of an automatic virtual memory mechanism. The most complicated part is how to detect those subgraph. I cannot go through the whole memory and okay, try to see each option if each subgraph is good or not. And I want to do to sort only and use the option. And it detects subgraph, but almost for all options are unused. So we start with an approach that it's called shooting, where you randomly you choose a number of options that are used. And you start to see, okay, you, and you start to traverse its own subgraph and try to create its biggest subgraph with a unique object. And then you start to iterate. And each time you shoot 100 more, and you start building subgraph. You start building, and maybe they are updated while the system is running. And you keep a table that points to the root of the subgraph.
Are you marking all objects or just the objects in the subgraph?
No, all the objects. The mark is nothing, it's no overhead, so I mark them all. But somehow I need to unmark them each every time. Because
all right, I think we have one last question, if it is possible to answer correctly.
Yeah, I think. Did you ever consider doing a different type of test?
Yes, sometimes it's fine. We have been discussing with Martin and Schoenfort and remember. Because they usually do the other approach. The option live forever to secondary disk, and they are sort in to primary memory when they are shoot and they kill back. In our case, it's different. We have our object in primary memory, and we swap out and use it. But it's just a point of view. We can talk with my supervisor that maybe we do it in the other way. So we are thinking.
Yeah,
it's another.
Because we don't understand the use case in next preferences from the
people. Yeah.
Okay, now let's finish here.